So we're back in the workshop. Thank you, Matt. We're back in looking at motors today. In a previous video presentation that Matt and Joe did, we went through the connections in what, Matt?
So that was a direct online starter single phase like the one that we have here. And we just went through the basic layout of an online starter and the connections, the numbers of the connections and where the basic wires went.
Okay, so that was on a whiteboard. We showed how those connections should be made in a single phase direct online starter. Yes. Then you developed that into another video where we looked at remote stop start.
Yes. Yeah.
In this video presentation, we've got a single phase motor, we've got a direct online start and remote stop start. We're going to physically show you those connections that you drew before. Yes, Matt?
Yes. Yeah.
So with that in mind, if I press the green button.
Yep, that should start.
Very good. If I press the red one.
Again, it should stop.
Green one. Red one. Okay. Yeah. Magic. Okay. So single phase motor, direct online. We're going to bring the camera in super close, Matt, and I just want you to go through all of those connections that link back to your previous two videos.
Fine.
So we've safely isolated the supply, we've taken the cover off. We've also disconnected the remote stop start element of this because the video that we looked at initially upstairs in the classroom with Matt and Joe had the direct online starter only and we added in the remote stop start. So for this video, we've disconnected the remote stop start and Matt's going to talk us through the connections going on in here. So what's going on, Matt?
Okay, guys, so we've got number one connection here and that's where our line supply comes in. So our main live supply comes in to number one here.
Okay.
And then it comes out on number two and directly down to the motor below.
Okay, so the motor's down here. So we come out of number two with the line conductor down at the bottom. Yes. Yeah.
We come in on number three with the neutral conductor. We come out of number four.
Yes.
And then it loops back round into number five.
Okay.
I think we did that on the drawing quite well.
Yes.
And then out on number six, again to the motor below.
So we're coming out of two and six down to the motor below, passing it through the actual contact here.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we've got this box here, and that is the overload relay.
Okay.
And so that's where that's why we go through, we loop through all of the contacts with the neutral conductor to ensure that all of the overload relay is being used.
Okay.
That's the reason for it.
This overload itself, can it be changed? It looks like we can unscrew it and take it out. Is it interchangeable with other overloads?
Yeah, so this one is rated at approximately about 13 amps.
Okay.
So we can quite easily remove that.
And while we're here, just for the AM2 and AM2S, can you just remind me what this little dial is doing here? Because I know on AM2S you have to fiddle around with that at some point.
So we'll just move this up, and I think on the you've got a little arrow here,
okay,
little arrow head, and again, just with a screwdriver, you can just turn this dial around to whatever setting you want it to be on. So at the moment, that's reading approximately, let's say 10 amps.
Okay, so the motor that would be below, normally on AM2S and AM2, there's a rated plate that you have to set your overload to, or it could be in the specification.
Yes.
Moving forward, they might even ask you to calculate, but it's vitally important that we set the overload appropriate to the motor that we connect.
Yes.
Everybody's motor is different as well, so that's another key thing to remember.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you for that, Matt. So more connections for me, please.
Okay then, so if you look on the line conductor where it comes in on number one, we also have a loop across to number 13.
Okay.
And then from number 13, which is a normally open contact, it then goes across to number 17.
So it comes from the back at 13, loops forward to 17?
Number 17,
okay.
Yeah. So to take note that number 1, number 13, and number 17 are permanently live connections.
Okay.
This is the start button.
Yep.
Okay, so it's a normally open start button.
Yep.
And so on the other side, number 18, the connection then goes from 18 to number 14, which is the other side of the retaining contacts.
Okay, so we went from the front side 18, we swung a little cable back to the back side to number 14,
That's it. So the start button in this case is in parallel with the retaining contacts.
Brilliant.
We then take a smaller cable. So there is something slightly different on this one. On the drawing, we showed a separate stop button.
Okay.
So on this one, and on many online starters, the stop buttons are actually interconnected into the overload relay.
So the green button that I saw on the front of the actual direct online starter is here.
Is this one.
And the red button is here.
Is this one.
Yeah, for the stop. Okay.
So normally, if you look on the drawing upstairs, we went from here to the stop button, and then out of the stop button into 95 96.
Okay, yeah.
In this case, we come directly from here, going through all the way in to 95.
And are these links that are normally actually in the actual direct online starter? It looks like that, you know, these have been added in afterwards. Do they come pre-linked, or are they you have to link them up yourself?
Again, when you buy an online starter, it only comes with the actual contactor. You buy the overload relay separate.
Okay.
But the wiring's all there. You just have to physically put the wiring in. You just have to physically do the connections into 95 and 96.
And that's what you're explaining to me. That's brilliant.
Yeah. So, from 96, so it comes through into 95, which is a normally closed contact.
Right.
It comes then out of 96,
yeah.
And then that comes all the way through, and it's quite hard to see on here, but terminals A1, which is the coil.
That's set back, yeah, so it's set back here, so that's A1. And we explained that on the other video presentation. It's probably a little bit easier to see it on a drawing than it is in reality. So you need to look in there and look for A1, yeah?
Yeah, A1 here. And then on the other side, A2, which is the neutral connection,
okay.
Then goes links across from the neutral into the neutral connection here.
So A2 being the other side of the coil. So we've got to energize the coil. So in other words, we need line on A1 and we need a neutral on A2. And you've taken it from this front neutral connection out of number 3 and effectively swung between the two terminals there.
That's it. Okay. Really important not to take a neutral from this termination, because remember, like we said on the video previously, that goes through the contactor. And for in order for the contact for this to be for this neutral to be operating, the contactor needs to be in play.
So that was number 5. We don't take it from number 5. We did that in a previous video presentation. We come from effectively the permanent neutral, which is in number 3. Yeah. So on A, is it A1 and A2, those terminals at the back?
Yes.
So one of them's got a line connection, one of them's got a neutral, and effectively that creates a magnetic field that pulls in the contactor.
And the contactor is this thing here. Yep. So as you push that in, it physically pushes in. And so now the contacts.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. So it's in and then let go and now. Okay. So that will, that's what we hear, don't we? We energize it and we hear da-dum. That's the contactor being pulled in. In other words, the energization of a coil. Right. Yes. Right. Fantastic.
Okay. There's a couple of other things on this one that I'd like to just draw your attention to that we didn't maybe show upstairs.
Okay.
Is the CPCs.
Ah, yes.
So I think I represented the CPC connection just with a little green square upstairs on the drawing, but obviously the CPCs are, it's paramount that the CPCs are all connected properly.
Exposed conductive part, CPCs are in the back. We were concentrating obviously on the line and neutral connections and the importance of getting them correct, but yeah, you're right, the CPCs need to be in there as well.
Yeah. So we also have, so when we said about the normally closed 95 and 96 terminal, when this trips, if there's an overload for whatever reason, on this particular type, you can manually reset it.
Okay, so that's a reset button there. Yes. If the motor was rated at 10 amps, it had an overloaded condition, maybe we put the motor under too much stress, it started taking 15, 16 amps, it would obviously trip out, but then we can manually reset it here.
Reset it there.
Right, really good. So if you watch Matt's and Joe's previous video on a direct online single phase starter, we've actually now come down in the workshop and shown you in situ the connections that were described in the drawings. We can go on and add these in for remote stop start, and that may be part of another presentation, but for this one it was all about, for our learners, can they make the connections for a single phase direct online motor as shown upstairs and within the actual starter itself. So me and Matt would like to say we hope this video has been some help.
It's been some help.